All right, let's begin. Let's start. We're going to do a little short class. Today's class, we're going to do a class on correction. Correction. What is correction, brothers? What is correction? Somebody tell me what correction is. Don't tell me your name. You changed your name. You got a Hebrew name, right? Yeah, still okay, James. What's correction, James? We got a mic. Hold on. Let me get you a mic. Also, too, I'm going to need a couple definitions and YouTube videos. You don't have to put them on the screen, but just pull them up.
Shalom.
What's correction, bro?
Fixing something that is not right.
Fixing something that's not right. Okay, elaborate on it.
Make it right.
Right? Okay, but how does correction take place? Who does it? Okay, What type of people does it involve, if I ask that question right?
Esau?
No. Correction.
Oh. I don't get it.
I don't want to give it away. I said if not. I don't want to be on day of that, but if you...
Shalom, Captain. Correction is for someone who's out of order.
Someone is out of order, and who else does it involve?
Leadership who is giving correction.
Okay, let me say this too. Is it always somebody that's out of order, meaning they're just unruly willingly doing it?
Not necessarily.
Okay,
it could just be us showing love to our brothers because we all need correction in order for us to gain the kingdom.
All right, okay, there we go. Malik, you had something, and then we'll come back up. I seen you, bro. Pass it all the way to the back. All the way to the back. We got another mic. We can get two out there.
Correction is, my bad, shalom leadership.
Shalom, brother.
Correction is changing who you were in a term of from a sinner to the righteous.
Okay, changing who you were. Changing who you were so you can be righteous in the end of it. That's the end result. All right, so pass it up to my brother Gerard. I'm saying it right? Trying to pronounce names right. I know I'll be jacking some sisters' name up. Brothers, too.
Shalom, leadership.
Shalom, brother. Most High Christ bless.
Correction is taking counsel from the leadership, the elders.
Okay, now, yourself. Say what you said again, because that's actually what I'm touching on right there. Say what you said again.
It's taking counsel from the leadership with the things you're doing wrong with yourself, but you have to acknowledge them first.
Okay. Taking counsel, taking correction from leadership and what else?
That's what I said.
That's it. Taking counsel, correction from leadership. That's what I'm dealing with today. And you're not wrong, but I'm saying that's what I'm dealing with today. What I want everybody to understand is that correction just don't have to come from leadership. Y'all understand that? Do y'all read the Bible in here, brothers? Sisters, y'all read the Bible in here? So y'all know correction? Y'all understand correction? Okay. So correction can come from anybody in here. Leadership as well, as well as those brothers out here, just as well as those sisters out here. That's one of the problems that we get wrong. We think only leadership can correct. It can cause a big issue. I'm going to tell you why. First, real quick, this wasn't even a part of the class, but I want to go to it. Go to Wisdom of Solomon. Also, this is actually what Moses actually said when he was leading us out of the wilderness. He looked back and said, "These people are just, we're a lot of people. If it's up to me, this is one job. This will drive me crazy. I need to set up men that's able to judge matters as well as I am." Solomon said the same exact thing. Go to Wisdom of Solomon chapter 6. I want you to start at verse 22. I want you to read all the way down to 24. Wisdom of Solomon. Raise your hand if you don't have an Apocrypha. If you're new, you don't have an Apocrypha. All right. We're going to begin at Wisdom of Solomon's. Wisdom of Solomon, chapter 6, read verse 22.
The book of Wisdom of Solomon, chapter 6. Chapter 6, verse 22. As for wisdom, what she is and how she came up, I will tell you and will not hide mysteries from you.
Okay.
But will seek her out from the beginning of her nativity and bring the knowledge of her unto light and will not pass over the truth. Neither will I go with consuming envy, for such a man shall have no fellowship with wisdom.
So Solomon was saying that when I gain wisdom, I didn't gain it for myself only, but all for all those that seek learning. So when I understand wisdom, what I want to do is share this with others. If I don't do this, James. It backs it up. It says, wisdom goeth without envy. That type of wisdom, if you're trying to gain it for yourself and you're trying to be boastful, just trying to show how much you know, that's not wisdom from above. It's devilish. It's sensual, not having the spirit. And the lack of better words, I think that's what it is. I'm paraphrasing it. That's not the wisdom that Solomon was talking about. Wisdom should be shared. If the Lord showed you something in the spirit based on the word, not opinion, it's your job to share that with others. This is the reason why. This is what Solomon's mindset on it. Read on, verse 24.
Verse 24. But the multitude.
But the what?
But the multitude.
Give me the definition, multitude. I love to pull definitions because I like to give the sense of what we're talking about. Give me the definition of multitude. Well, okay, this is scripture that was in James, if you just want to write it down. 3:17. Start verse 14. Actually 13 all the way down to 17. That's the scripture that was quoted. So here we go. Multitude, the definition of multitude, a large number. Simply that. Everybody, a large number. Large number of people, a large gathering of people. Read on.
But the multitude of the wise is...
But the multitude of the what?
Of the wise...
Is the what?
Is the welfare of the world.
The multitude of the wise is the welfare of the world. What? Now give me the definition of welfare. It is the welfare of the world. The multitude of the wise. It's helpful for everybody to be wise because it would do what? By the definition of welfare, what is it? To the health, the happiness... The fortunes of a person or a group, right? So it's the health. It's beneficial. It's necessary. Says the read it again, 24.
But the multitude of the wise.
The multitude of the wise. If everybody was wise, it is the what?
It is the welfare of the world.
Everybody would benefit from it. Everybody would be correcting this. This is what Christ is bringing us back to. This is why when he said, it's going to come at a point in the time where we are in the kingdom. No man should no longer teach his neighbor saying, know ye the Lord? Because all of us are going to know him in that day. Meaning there's going to be no need for camp to be set up. Everybody's going to know what we're supposed to be doing. Everybody's going to have knowledge of the Bible. Everybody's going to know how to properly carry themselves. That's what that scripture is going to. It says the multitude of the wise is the welfare of the world. So correction can come from anybody in here, but you got to be given the counsel according to the Bible, okay? And then I'm going to elaborate on that when I say that too. Correction come from the Bible because it's another thing I want to talk about because I heard this in counsels, in a marriage counsel. Very wrong understanding. All right, let's begin. 2 Timothy 3:16. Second Timothy, 3:16. Read that.
The book of 2 Timothy, chapter 3, verse 16. All scripture is given by inspiration of God.
What are we talking about?
All scripture is given by inspiration of God.
All scripture is given by the inspiration of God. What is inspiration? A divine influence. Divine influence. Now, this is what I heard in a marriage counsel before, dealing with these two couples. The brother and his wife was having an argument in the house. The brother took it to the point where his wife was trying to give him correction. She didn't know the scriptures as he knew it, but she would paraphrase him. She would quote him. The brother say, I'm not listening to her because she didn't give me the chapter in the verse. That's wrong. Divine influence. Correction can come from somebody that's divinely influenced. So you don't know half the... I think I said this to the sisters one time. It was a question that was asked to me. You don't have to know the scripture in the verse to give somebody counsel. If you know what you're talking about and it's coming out of the Bible, you can tell that person that is correction from the scriptures. Don't ever get that confused because you didn't quote the chapter and the verse. I ain't listening to you. That's wrong. Give me that real quick in the book of Wisdom of Solomon. The book of Sirach. Sirach chapter 4, verse 24. Sirach chapter, or Ecclesiasticus in the Apocrypha chapter 4, verse 24.
The book of Sirach chapter 4, verse 24. For by speech, wisdom shall be known.
Read it again.
For by speech, wisdom shall be known.
For by your speech, wisdom shall be known. What is the wisdom? If you read that verse above what we read in 2 Timothy 3:16, it tells you, as a child, thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise. Wisdom is the scriptures. It says, for by speech, wisdom shall be known. So just by a person talking to you, correcting you, they don't have to exactly know the verse in the chapter, but the wisdom is within the sentence of the speech that they're giving you. It's divinely inspired. God is talking to you. So don't never get this to the point where you're saying, well, that person didn't quote the verse in chapter, so I ain't got to listen to that. That's your opinion. If you do that, you're heading for a path of destruction.
I just want to bring that out even further, like the captain is saying. Let's go to Sirach chapter 8, verse 8 real quick. And then I'm going to jump to another scripture. Just these two lines.
The book of Sirach, chapter 8, verse 8. Despise not the discourse of the wise.
Do what?
Despise not the discourse of the wise.
The scripture says, you know, wisdom is coming out, and that's who the wise is. The wisdom is coming from the scriptures. The wise is the person that's actually speaking of the wisdom. It says, despise not the discourse of the wise. From that, let's jump to Sirach chapter 6, verse 35. Because naturally, we all know right from wrong. So if you dealing with a certain spirit and you're not trying to examine yourself and there's wisdom going out, you got the devil on you.
That's right.
You have the devil on you. So read this. What does the Bible say on how you're supposed to take correction?
Sirach chapter 6, verse 35. Be willing to hear every godly discourse.
And you're hearing the discourse coming out. So if you have a problem with that, you have a problem with God, because that's the reason why y'all out here right now. That's why we opening up the book. To change the ways that we used to have to what we need to be in this Bible. You know what I'm saying? I heard a sister or brother explain this real quick. Explain the Bible is, this is our mirror. We're supposed to reflect the things that are in these scriptures. Meaning you have to change. If you in here, you're going to change. That's it on that, Cap.
Okay, from that, go to Sirach chapter 32, verse 18. That's right. Correction couldn't go to anybody. Matter of fact, this is the reason why we're around each other. For correction, this goes, and this the scripture backs up that statement when it says that he sent prophets, he sent teachers, he sent evangelists, he sent ministers for the edifying of the body, that we may grow up into the fullness and the stature of Christ. The body may grow up to the fullness and the stature of Christ. The body represents the church. He gave those type of teachers for the edifying of the body. They might edify themselves, that they may grow up together. So they're supposed to be correcting each other, supposed to be teaching each other. So if you're around the church, that's what's supposed to happen there. I'm going to say something else on that. I got a lot of thoughts I got to get out, but I got to deal with that after the class. I want to say something as we close, addressing a different situation. But let's read this real quick.
The book of Sirach, chapter 32, verse 18. A man of counsel will be considerate.
It says what?
A man of counsel will be considerate.
Now, dealing with counsel, is it a man of counsel? If you desire counsel and if you love counsel, it says a man of counsel, he will be what?
Considerate.
He will be considerate. Now, let's deal with marriage for a second. If your wife, and I'll speak for myself on this, dealing in my house, my wife, I forget, she told me something. And I was like, I had to check myself. I'm like, she's telling me this. It cut me to the heart. She told me something. It was something small. It was just like, she told me about something. For a second, I was like, man, I'm a man. Why telling me this? I'm a man. I'm supposed to be teaching you. That's the wrong way to think. Even if it don't apply to you, still consider it. It's something you can use out of it. Correction is, it says what?
a man of counsel.
If you're a man of counsel and you love to hear correction, you will do what?
Will be considerate.
Even if it don't apply to you, even if that person is coming to you wrong and you didn't do it, listen to what they're saying. Maybe they could apply to you later on down the line. A person that is rejecting counsel, you're not a man of God. That's what it's saying. A man of counsel, he's going to consider, even if it don't apply to you. From that, let's go to the book of Proverbs chapter 20, verse 5.
That's right, what you were saying, like the scripture we went before that. It said, be willing to hear every godly discourse.
Be willing to hear
you're supposed to want to hear it.
Also, the scripture says, be not ignorant of any matters, whether great or small. Listen to everything. If they're telling you, and it's divinely inspired, it's come out of the scripture, God wants you to hear it. Whether or not it applied to you then, it applied to you some way because it came out. So let's go from that. Let's go to the book of Proverbs chapter 20. I want you to read verse 5.
The book of Proverbs chapter 20, verse 5. Counsel in the heart of man is
counsel
like
in the heart of a man. Like when you're given a counsel, now you just have all these thoughts. Even when you're thinking of counsel on what you should be doing, like you, all of these thoughts, you just get so many thoughts on how you should go about a situation. You get all these type of scenarios on how you should go about it. Or somebody's giving you a problem or giving you some counsel. It said a man of counsel is like deep water. It could be information that's useless to you, but you're going to listen to it. It's like deep water. But what? Read on.
But a man of understanding.
But a man of understanding is going to what?
Will draw it out.
Will draw it out. Meaning it doesn't have to apply to you because you're going to take what you need from it. So if somebody's trying to correct you, even at the point like somebody come to you and say, brother, I ain't like the way you looked at me. I think you got a problem. Like, man, listening to you, you exaggerating. What's wrong with you? No, I'm going to consider. Maybe I need to change something about myself. Let me see what way I can, you know, maybe I got some character flaws I need to work on. Be considerate. A man of counsel, he's going to draw out what he can take from it. A woman of counsel is going to draw out what she can take from it. Be ignorant of no counsel. That's what's going to save your life. Read it again.
Proverbs chapter 20, verse 5. Counsel in the heart of man is like deep water, but a man of understanding.
But if you have understanding, read on.
Will draw it out.
You're going to draw out of it what you need. Exactly what you need from that counsel. Proverbs chapter 5, verse 1.
Book of Proverbs, chapter 5, verse 1.
Now we're going to get an example about who we all know, King Solomon.
My son, attend unto my wisdom and bow thine ear to my understanding.
Read on.
That thou mayest regard discretion.
Okay, just to show you who we're talking about and who wrote this, real quick, let's jump back in the chapter. Read 1 and 1. We're going to come back to that same book.
Proverbs, chapter 1, verse 1. The Proverbs of Solomon.
Who are we talking about?
The Proverbs of Solomon.
Read on.
The son of David.
Read on.
King of Israel.
Read.
To know wisdom.
To know what?
To know wisdom.
And what?
And instruction.
Uh-huh.
To perceive the words of understanding.
Read on.
To receive the instruction of wisdom, justice, and judgment, and equity. To give subtlety to the simple, to the young man knowledge and discretion. A wise man will hear.
A wise man will what?
A wise man will hear.
Listen, we have 31 chapters in the book of Proverbs. Solomon said, before I even go into depth on what I'm trying to tell you out of these 31 chapters, you got to be willing to what?
A wise man will hear.
A wise man will hear. And read on.
And will increase learning.
That's the only way you're going to understand anything in life, period. You got to hear. Read on.
And a man of understanding shall attain unto wise counsels.
And unto wise counsels. Now let's see what happened into his life that where he got to this point where he had to explain it in this way. You have to listen. What happened to Solomon in his life? We know Solomon was the wisest king, the wisest man on this earth we ever had. Okay. Let's see what happened to him in his life. Let's read this. Let's go back to chapter 5. Read verse 1 again.
Proverbs chapter 5, verse 1. My son, attend unto my wisdom and bow thine ear to my understanding.
When it says bow down thy ear to my understanding, it's to mean humble yourself. We all have ears to listen, but are you really listening? That's why it says he that hath an ear, let him hear. What it was talking about were people that have understanding to listen, whether they were willing to humble their hearts. Because we all have ears. This is why it said, also you hear the proverb say, you have eyes and you see not. You have ears, but you hear not. Some people will be listening, but they ain't really listening. It's not connecting up here. Solomon said, bow your ear unto what?
To my understanding.
To his understanding. Let's read on.
That thou mayest regard discretion.
That thou mayest regard discretion. Read on.
And that thy lips may keep knowledge. For the lips of a strange woman.
This is how you retain the information that's given to you. You got to bow your heart. You can repeat knowledge and just forget it. Because if you forget it, that means you really didn't apply it to your understanding. You just heard it for some time. It didn't really resonate with your spirit. You can't really, it's not a part of your knowledge. It's just somebody just, it, really what it is just going in one ear and out the other. But it says that thou mayest regard discretion, thy lips may keep understanding. That's the purpose. That's the point we got to get to. When we able to keep understanding. Read on.
For the lips of a strange woman drop as an honeycomb, and her mouth is smoother than oil. But her end is bitter as wormwood, sharp as a two-edged sword.
Now we're going to get into Solomon's life and find out what happened to him and what was his downfall. Okay, jump down to verse 8.
Proverbs chapter 5, verse 8. Remove thy way far from her and come not nigh the door of her house.
Because Solomon, who knows what happened to Solomon in his point in time in life? What did he do that was wrong? Let me get some new hands. Let me see. Let me get Abaddon.
He married strange women from other nations.
He did what?
Married with strange women, other nations.
He married strange women from other nations. Now, tell me, where was that law? What book was that law?
I think that's in Deuteronomy.
Deuteronomy where? You right there.
7:3.
Okay. All right. Was this before Solomon's time or after Solomon's time? Let me get some hands. Who don't know, raise your hand. Who don't know, raise your hand. Who knows, raise your hand. All right, so I should have got that hand, that same result the first time. Come on, brothers. Who knows, was this before Solomon's time or after Solomon's time? Raise your hand if you know it. All right, so let's get an answer. Let's see. Yo, Cannon, let me get your hand. I saw your hand in the spirit, brother. You was raising it. I saw you back there. Was this before Solomon's time or after Solomon's time?
You talk about Deuteronomy, right?
Deuteronomy, that law.
That law, that was before.
That was before his time.
Yeah.
Okay. There's a reason why I'm saying that. Read verse 8 again.
Proverbs chapter 5, verse 8. Remove thy way far from her and come not nigh the door of her house.
Now, Solomon was talking about women in this case. Okay, twofold situation, but he's talking about women. This is what he was dealing with when he began to fall. Read on.
Lest thou give thine honor unto others.
Lest thou give thine honor unto others. Read on.
And thy years unto the cruel.
Read.
Lest strangers be filled with thy wealth, and thy labors be in the house of a stranger.
Read on.
And thou mourn at the last.
Hold on. Give me one second. Read on.
When thy flesh and thy body are consumed.
At the last moment, when you have rejected counsel, this is what he's talking about. Read on.
And say, how have I hated instruction?
How
have I hated instruction?
Read on.
And my heart despised reproof.
Read.
And have not obeyed the voice of my teachers.
You see why counsel is necessary? You won't get to the point where now there's regret. You have to think back on these things and say, man, I should have did this. I should have did this. Now I got to the point where all of my labors are now given to somebody else. If I would have done this, I would have listened to my teachers. I wouldn't have been in this situation. This is the reason for counselors. This is the reason why we are together. This is the reason why we should all know the scriptures so we can correct one another. Then we wouldn't repeat the same steps that Solomon is into now. I want to read this real quick. This was not a part of the lesson, but I want to read it. Showing you about how we should view every example that we read in this Bible. Give me the book of Proverbs. We're going to come back to this. Proverbs 24, verse 30.
The book of Proverbs, chapter 24, verse 30. I went by the field of
okay.
the...
Now, this was an analogy, okay? This was not an actual situation, but he's giving you a parable. It says, I went, read on.
I went by the field of the slothful.
Of the slothful, read on.
And by the vineyard of the man void of understanding.
And I went by this vineyard, this man that didn't have no understanding whatsoever. Read on.
And lo, it was all grown over with thorns.
It was a vineyard that he planted to reap from it. But however, this man of understanding, his vineyard was all overgrown with thorns. Read on.
And nettles had covered the face thereof.
Now, this is something that is not supposed to be in a vineyard, obviously. This is what you call weeds today. It's all overgrown with thorns and with nettles. Read on.
And the stone wall thereof was broken down.
And the stone wall thereof was broken down. The stone wall was actually what was supposed to keep the thorns and the nettles out. It was all broken down. Read on.
Then I saw.
Then I what?
Then I saw.
And did what?
And considered it
and
well.
And considered it. It wasn't my garden to worry about. It was his. But you know how I can, what I can take from this situation? It can happen to me. He says, I saw and what?
Then I saw and considered.
And what?
It well. I looked upon it.
I looked upon it.
And received instruction.
And I received instruction. However, it didn't apply to me, but you know what? I receive instruction from this. That's how we got to take counsel and that's how we got to take counsel and correction. All right, so let's go back and let's continue with Solomon. Read verse, that's Proverbs, what was that? 24? 30? Yeah. Let's go back to Solomon. Read verse 12 again, 5 and 12.
Proverbs chapter 5, verse 12. And say, how have I hated instruction?
Read.
And my heart despised reproof, and have not obeyed the voice of my teachers.
Have I not obeyed the voice of who?
My teachers.
My teachers. Read on.
Nor incline my ear to them that instructed me.
And nor incline my ear to them that instructed me. Read, let's go back from that. Let's get some history on him now. Let's go to the book of 1 Kings chapter 10. 1 Kings chapter 10. Let's read verse 23.
The book of 1 Kings chapter 10 verse 23. So King Solomon exceeded all the kings of the earth. For riches and for wisdom.
For riches and for wisdom. He had a lot of understanding. Read on.
And all the earth sought to Solomon to hear his wisdom, which God had put in his heart.
Read on.
And they brought every man his present, vessels of silver and vessels of gold and garments and armor and spices, horses and mules, a rate year by year. And Solomon gathered together chariots and horsemen.
Uh-oh, here we go.
And he had 1,400 chariots.
Here we go.
And 12,000 horsemen.
Read on.
Whom he bestowed in the cities for chariots.
So at verse 25, Solomon was reverenced for his understanding. He was given things because everybody that came to him, they received some counsels on how to deal right in their kingdoms. So let me go down to see what this king got to say. He always has some wise counsels. Maybe I can use this to apply back to my nation. Let me go down there and hear what he got to say. You'll hear about all these kings came down to reverence. I mean, they brought gifts. But 26 is now where we start to get in Solomon's life. This is where we see the downfall of his life. And he told you how he got there. How have I not obeyed the voice of my teachers? Read 26 again.
1 Kings chapter 10, verse 26. And Solomon gathered together chariots and horsemen. And he had 1,400 chariots and 12,000 horsemen, whom he bestowed in the cities for chariots and with the king at Jerusalem. And the king made silver to be in Jerusalem as stones, and cedars made he to be as the sycamore trees that are in the vale for abundance. And Solomon had horses.
And Solomon had what?
Had horses.
Read on.
Brought out of Egypt. And linyard. The king's merchants received the linen yard at a price.
Read on.
And a chariot came up and went out of Egypt for 600 shekels of silver.
Read on.
And an horse for 150.
And what?
For 150.
Read on.
And so for all the kings of the Hittites and for the kings of Syria. Did they bring them out by their means?
Okay, so what went wrong in Solomon's life? How have he not obeyed the voice of his teacher? I see him, but we're going to read it. I want to get to it. Let me hear what you got to say first. I'm going to see if you're thinking it. Let me get Elijah. Sorry, brother.
Shalom. I think there's a law in Deuteronomy where it says you cannot multiply
horses. Let's get it. Yeah. Let's get it. There we go. There we go. Let's get it. Yes, sir. Deuteronomy 17. Here's where it went wrong. Deuteronomy 17, 15.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 17, verse 15. Thou shalt in any wise set him king over thee.
Okay, it's talking about whom the Lord shall choose when you get into the land. Read on.
Whom the Lord thy God shall choose, one from among thy brethren.
One from what?
One from among thy brethren.
Another topic, but we ain't supposed to have no president that ain't our nation. No king. He ain't our race. He ain't supposed to be over us. That goes to show you we're in the wrong position on this earth. Princes walking upon grounds and servants upon horses. Everything is backwards. Okay. Read on.
Shall thou set king over thee?
And the last time I checked, Obama don't come from neither one of those tribes. I mean, Trump. He ain't come from now one of the tribes. He's an Edomite. We're in the wrong position. This is why we can't get comfortable. Read on.
Thou mayest not set a stranger over thee.
That's who he is. Trump, Donald Trump is a stranger. He's an Edomite. Read on.
Which is not thy brother.
Read on.
But he shall not multiply horses to himself.
Now dealing back with King Solomon. What was the law?
But he shall not multiply horses to himself.
Did King Solomon do that, brothers? Read on.
Nor cause the people to return to Egypt.
Nor cause their minds to return to Egypt. Read on.
To the end that he should multiply horses. For as much as the Lord have said unto you, ye shall henceforth return no more that way.
Read on.
Neither shall he multiply wives to himself.
Neither shall he do what?
Multiply wives to himself.
We're going to read it, but Solomon did this. Read on.
That his heart turn not away. Neither shall he greatly multiply to himself silver and gold.
Everything that we're reading, Solomon ended up doing it. Read on.
And it shall be when he sitteth upon the throne of his kingdom that he shall write him a copy of this law in a book out of that which is before the priests and Levites.
Read.
And it shall be with him, and he shall read therein all the days of his life.
Verse 19 again.
And it shall be with him that, and he shall read therein all the days of his life.
Read again.
And it shall be with him, and he shall read therein all the days of his life.
Read on.
That he may learn to.
That he may what?
That he may learn.
To do what?
To fear the Lord his God.
So what happened in his life? He stopped reading. He stopped fearing the Lord. He stopped listening to those that were with him to give him wise counsels. Read on.
To keep all the words of this law and these statutes to do them, that his heart be not lifted up above his brethren.
Now, real quick, give me the one in Second Kings, when the kingdom split, when Rehoboam started to take over. I want to read something out of that. Chapter 12.
The book of First Kings, chapter 12, verse 6. And King Rehoboam consulted with the old men that stood before Solomon his father.
So who was around Solomon? Older men that had understanding of the law, that was helping them in the kingdom. You don't think they were saying, Solomon, what's wrong with you? This right here, what you're doing is wrong. Why are you doing this? What is this? Why you got all these horses out? Who are all of these women? You don't think Solomon had that understanding? He had men that were around him. He said the multitude of the wise is the welfare of the world. What do you think counsels they were giving him? Solomon, you wrong. I've been up with you to this point right here, but this right here is out of order. There were men around Solomon. So let's go back to Kings. Let's finish that off. There were men around him telling him what he should do. Did we finish that off in Deuteronomy? That his heart may not be lifted up? Let's finish that off in Deuteronomy. Finish off at verse 20. 17, 20.
Deuteronomy chapter 17, verse 20.
So we went to 1 Kings to show you that he wasn't the only one dealing with it by himself. So he just didn't fall by himself because he had not the understanding. He fell because pride grew within him. He stopped listening to counsel. He stopped listening to correction. He got into himself. Read on.
That his heart be not lifted up above his brethren.
That's what happened. Read on.
And that he turn not aside from the commandment, to the right hand or to the left, to the end that he may prolong his days in his kingdom.
Okay. He, read on,
and his children in the midst of Israel.
So let's go back and let's finish that off in Kings 10. First Kings chapter 10. Let's finish this off. 11 and 1.
First Kings chapter 11 verse 1. But King Solomon loved many strange women, together with the daughter of Pharaoh, women of the Moabites, Ammonites, Edomites, Zidonians, and Hittites.
Read on.
Of the nations concerning which the Lord said unto the children of Israel, ye shall not go in into them.
Read on.
Neither shall they come in unto you, for surely they will turn away your heart after their gods. Solomon clave unto these in love.
Solomon clave unto these in love. And what did he do? Verse 3.
And he had 700 wives, princesses, and 300 concubines.
Read on.
And his wives turned away his heart.
To where he started to worship other gods. This brings us back to Proverbs chapter 5. Let's go back to Proverbs chapter 5 and read that again. 5 and 13.
Proverbs chapter 5 verse 13.
This is why he came back and wrote the book that he wrote. After all that stuff that he went through, he repented. And this is what he came back and said after he gained understanding. This is why we should be repeating the same things. Read on.
And have not obeyed the voice of my teachers, nor inclined my ear to them that instructed me. I almost in all evil in the midst of the congregation and assembly.
Okay, he says, I was almost in all evil in the midst of the congregation and assembly. He almost died in his sins. But what happened to him is what we're about to find out. Go to, from that to Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse 16. So this is the reason why we can't think we got it all. Read on. 7:16.
Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse 16.
Now he's about to tell you how he failed.
Be not righteous over much.
Be not what?
Be not righteous over much.
Because we all sin. We all fall short of the glory. That's why we need each other. That's why we are around each other. Read on.
Neither make thyself overwise.
Neither make thyself what?
Overwise.
Overwise. Read on.
Why shouldest thou destroy thyself?
So if you're overwise to where nobody can't tell you nothing, you're going to destroy yourself. That's what it's saying. You overwise so nobody can't correct you? You too good for a correction? You're going to destroy yourself. That's what it's saying. Read on.
Be not overmuch wicked, neither be thou foolish. Why shouldest thou die before thy time?
Read.
It is good that thou shouldest take hold of this.
And going verse 17, he said, don't get to the point where you saying, well, grace may abound. I can just sin. You know, we're under grace. Ain't nobody perfect. You're going to destroy yourself in that too. It says, don't be over wicked. We all going to fall short. Right? Righteous man falls 7 times, but he's going to get back up. He ain't going to find an excuse to do his own will. It says a hypocrite is offended in the law. That's what it says. Read on.
Ecclesiastes chapter 7 verse 18. It is good that thou shouldest take hold of this.
These two things, becoming not overwise, becoming over righteous and not being over wicked, unto these things, take good hold of it. Read on.
Yea, also from this withdraw not thine hand.
Don't withdraw your hand to perform these things. Read on.
For he that feareth God. Shall come forth of them all.
That's why it says a wise man will consider counsel. He's going to love counsel because he know that's the Lord speaking to him. He that feareth God shall overcome, come forth of these all. He's going to overcome them all. Real quick, let's go to the book, back to the book of 2 Timothy, chapter 3. Now I got another example to give you. In the same book that we started off with, when we read about correction. All of these things come from God. They come from the scripture, inspiration of God. Let's give you an example. Let's read chapter 3, read verse 1.
2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1. This know also that in the last days perilous times shall come, for men shall be lovers of their own selves.
Self-will, about themselves, selfish, not considerate. About themselves. Read on.
Covetous. Boasters. Covetous.
Want what everybody has. Ungodly. Okay, you want what they have and not trying to work with what they have, but you just desire what they have. You coveting. Read on.
Boasters.
Boasters. proud spirits, boasting of what you have. Read on.
Proud.
And proud to where nobody can't tell you anything. Read on.
Blasphemers.
Saying something that's in the word of God, that you saying something that is in the word of God, but it's not. Read on.
Disobedient to parents.
Children becoming disobedient to parents. Christ said this is the law that came with a covenant, an agreement, that you have everlasting life. Disobedient to parents. The first commandment with promise. That's what it said. Do you not know, this is not even the topic, but I got to say this. There's a scripture in here. It says, matter of fact, let's read it because this is something that we needed to touch on. Yeah, Sirach 7:27. Disobedient to parents.
The book of Sirach, chapter 7, verse 27. Honor thy father with thy whole heart.
Okay, and this can also go into fathers in this truth. Spiritual fathers. Honor thy father with thy what?
Thy whole heart.
Like Paul said it. Not in my presence only, but outside of my presence. Read on.
And forget not the sorrows of thy mother.
And forget not the sorrows of thy mother. The mother, your mother birthed you. Right? She went through all this pain and labor to have you. Forget not the sorrows of thy mother. Read on.
Remember that thou was begotten of them.
As a child, we supposed to do what?
Remember that thou was begotten of them.
For the young man that's in here, I don't know who you are as of yet. Lord's will we speak after. You better remember that you were begotten of your parents. And remember that they brought you into this earth. And what did God tell us to do? Read on.
And how canst thou recompense them the things that they have done for thee?
And there ain't no way you can repay them on how they brought. There ain't nothing you can do to repay them for what they have done for you. Bringing you into this world. You know, that was by grace that a mother can. You know, every time a mother gives a child, that's grace by the Lord. A mother, that was one of the curses that the Lord put above on women. That they die in childbearing. If they're saved through childbearing, God is dealing with them. Meaning God is working with you too. So for you to turn around and disrespect your parents, you disrespect the Lord. It says, remember that thou was begotten of them. And how canest thou what?
Recompense them.
Meaning repay. Read on.
The things that they have done for thee.
So you're supposed to be reverencing your parents. That's what the scripture says. Read on.
Fear the Lord with all thy soul.
That's all I want on that. You better fear the Lord with all thy soul. Breaking that commandment, you don't fear the Lord. Okay?
Hey, so listen. I just want to add something to that right quick, if I can. Sirach 3:16, just to back up that point there.
The book of Sirach, chapter 3, verse 16. He that forsaketh his father is a blasphemer.
Mm-hmm, read on.
And he that angereth his mother is cursed of God.
Read that last part again.
And he that angereth his mother is cursed of God.
So the scriptures say that if you forsake your father, you are a blasphemer. Because the scripture says that you're supposed to honor your father and your mother. And if you anger your mother, you are cursed of God. I want whoever that's aimed for to meditate on that scripture. That you are cursed of God. And all of you that may know him, you need to separate yourselves until he get himself right.
Brother got to correct himself. We all have to look out for each other's soul in here. And this scripture that we're going to, it applies for many others in here. There's another situation, other couple brothers that was dealing with this too. This is for y'all too. Not only for that brother, but this goes for everybody in here. Now it says, obey your parents obey your parents in the Lord. No, the scripture in Ephesians, obey your parents in the Lord. 6 and 5, right? 6 and 4. Now, when it going into that, we supposed to respect our parents. That's the law. Whether they in the truth or out of the truth, you deal with them according to as they are your parents. Now, if your mother's telling you go run down the store on the Sabbath and get some pork, no. That's not what he was talking about. It says, obey your parents in the Lord, for that is right. It's talking about things in regarding righteousness. Okay, that's y'all understand that, right? Okay, let's go back. Let's read on in 2 Timothy. We left off at verse 3.
The book of 2 Timothy.
I mean, end of verse 2. Obedient to parents, disobedient to parents.
The book of 2 Timothy chapter 3 verse 2. For men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful.
Unthankful. You being ungrateful when somebody give you something. Read on.
Unholy.
Not keeping the commandments of all. You unholy in all your ways. Your character. Read on.
Without natural affection.
Read on.
Truce breakers.
Read on.
False accusers.
Read on.
Incontinent.
Read.
Fierce. Despisers of those that are good.
Uh-huh.
Traitors. Heady. High-minded. Lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God.
More lovers of pleasures is more than God. Read on.
Having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof.
Having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. Meaning denying the counsel that you're giving. You having the form of it, but in your spirit, your inner man, you hate everything that person is trying to tell you. It says, read on.
From such, turn away.
From such, turn away. Read on.
For of this sort are they which creep into houses and lead captive silly women laden with sins, led away with diverse lusts.
Okay, here's the point I wanted to get to in dealing with correction. What, this is the, read on. Verse 7.
Verse 7. Ever learning. And never able to come to the knowledge of the truth.
Somebody said it earlier. Who said it? I think it was Zerah. You said it. What did you say earlier when I asked you correction? What correction was? I think it was back there. Maybe it wasn't you.
Right. He was saying being able to basically check yourself.
Okay. He said something else.
To seek counsel. Okay. He was saying not only seek counsel from. He's saying seek counsel from leadership. And then take.
He said leadership.
Yeah. He said leadership. And that's okay. When he brought out not only leadership, but also to seek counsel to correct yourself. That's what he was saying.
All right. Okay. What he said was correction was it was necessary because we can learn something from it. We're supposed to grow from it in so many words. That's what he was saying. That's what he was getting at. That it's necessary for us to grow from it. Right. That's why I quoted earlier when he says that that's the reason why the teachers were set up to edify us, that we may grow together. Now, going back to the point in verse 7, it says, ever learning, able, read on verse 7 again.
2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 7, ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth.
So that's what you're supposed to come to. After the correction, that person's desire is to get you to be able to humble your spirit and come to the truth, to realize that you've been wrong in a situation. Right? Y'all with me? Sisters, y'all with me? Read it again.
2 Timothy chapter 3 verse 7. Ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth.
We're supposed to be doing the opposite of this. Now I'm going to give you the example. Read verse 8.
Verse 8.
This is why these men were never able to come to the truth. We're talking about Egyptians now. Read on.
Now as Jannes and Jambres withstood Moses.
Jannes and Jambres are those two people that stood before Moses. When Moses gave forth his enchantments, they did what?
So do these also resist the truth.
How did they resist the truth? It's the reason why I'm using this example. How did they resist the truth? Let's get that real quick in Wisdom of Solomon 18:13. How did they resist the truth? And what does this have to do with correction? Wisdom of Solomon.
Wisdom of Solomon. 18:13.
Read on.
Chapter 18, verse 13. For whereas they would not believe anything by reason of the enchantments.
So Moses tried to persuade these heathens, look, you need to let us go. Here's some signs. All the people say, look, Pharaoh, we need to let these people go. That God ain't playing with them. All of them turned their hearts because they were not able to come to the truth because of the what?
For whereas they would not believe anything by reason of the enchantments.
Because every time Moses did something, they came back and said, look, don't worry about that. We can do it too. Now, what does this have to do with correction? Somebody trying to tell you something, and you say, know what? I ain't worrying about that. Because you remember what you did? What about what you did? I remember when you did this to me. You're going to come at me and tell me about something. What about you? They were not able to come forth to the truth because they always had something, some kind of rebuttal after that. If this is your spirit, you're going to be destroyed just like them Egyptians. They was not able to come forth to the truth because they always had an excuse. Even dealing with counselors. Sister, what's your problem with this? Did this and this and this. Okay, that's a good point. But what's your problem? Well, she do this too. And I remember, look at this. Okay. what's happening now? Well, and it's go back and forth. It could be on the flip side, the sister doing the same thing. Everybody's trying to dig up evil, not able to let go of that stuff and move on with different situations. We're changed now. We're repenting now. What's going on now? We got to stop learning to stop digging up evil. You understand? Stop going, trying to go tooth for tooth and nail to nail. What's going on now? If somebody's trying to tell you something, don't try to remember what happened or how they offended you before so you can bring it back out. You're supposed to get past that. This is what these men were doing. Every time something was given to them, they try to rebuttal. Well, what about this? That's how they were never able to come to the truth, to acknowledge their wrongs. Let's go from that to Isaiah 58, verse 9. What type of spirit is this? Isaiah 58, we're almost done. 58, verse 9.
The book of Isaiah, chapter 58, verse 9. Then shall thou call, and the Lord shall answer. Thou shalt cry, and he shall say, Here I am. If thou take away from the midst of thee the yoke, the putting forth of the finger.
The do what?
The putting forth of the finger.
Read on.
And speaking vanity.
And speaking vanity. The putting forth of the finger and speaking vanity. God said this is a yoke. This is something we all just have in our minds to do. Well, making you feel uncomfortable because you're getting corrected. You're on the spot like, well, what about you? What you did this? That guy said, that's a yoke. Put away from me the putting of the finger. That's not what's supposed to be going on. Let's drop that. Let's go to Sirach chapter 20, verse 1. Put away from you the putting forth of the finger. It's vanity. That's what God said. It's vanity. It means nothing. You'll get nowhere in those type of situations. You always have some evil to dig up if you can't let go. That's a forever going battle.
And you know what's heavy about what you just said, Captain, is that sometimes they might not point the finger at you, but they'll say, but what about this brother, this sister, which means they've been knowing that this brother, sister been out of order.
Exactly.
And ain't saying nothing.
That's evil. That is evil. So let's go to this is what kind of spirit that is. Matter of fact, let's go to Ecclesiasticus chapter 20, verse 1.
The book of Sirach, chapter 20, verse 1.
Matter of fact, this is not the spirit, but this is something I want to touch on. I will get to the spirit of that later. Read on.
There is a reproof that is not comely.
There is a reproof that is what?
That is not comely.
Correction don't always feel good. Somebody's correcting an issue that you have never dealt with. And they bring it to light. You ain't going to feel happy about it right then and there. Correction is not always comely. But it's going to help you. Read on.
Again, some man holdeth his tongue.
He that holdeth his tongue is what?
And he is wise.
He is wise. You ain't waiting for your moment to respond. Always have something to say after that. He said, he that holds his tongue is wise. You're going to consider what he's just saying. He or she might be wrong, but let me acknowledge what they're saying. Read on.
It is much better to reprove than to be angry secretly.
It is better to reprove than to be angry secretly. This goes for thus a situation happening here. Somebody did you wrong. Somebody crossed you in some type of way. It is better to reprove, to go to that person than be angry secretly. Now it's turning into hatred. It was something small, but you haven't dealt with it. Now it's growing to a hatred. You ain't speaking to them next Sabbath. And now they ain't speaking to you because they feel that you've got something against them. They just ain't talking to you. Like, I'll wait till she come out, whatever she's dealing with. Then they don't speak to you the following Sabbath. Yeah, she hate me for real. That's why I don't like her. That's why I don't like him. When it was your problem in the first place. They haven't been talking to you because they're trying to give you your space. And now you turned that into some evil. You see that? Read again.
Sirach chapter 20, verse 2. It is much better to reprove.
That's why it says much better to reprove. Read on.
Than to be angry secretly.
Read on.
And he that confesseth his fault shall be preserved from hurt.
Hurt to yourself. Confess your faults, you'll be preserved from hurt. Hurt. Read on.
How good is it when thou art reproved?
How good is it when thou art what?
Reproved.
Read on.
To show repentance.
To show repentance. We're going to get a scripture on that later. He says what? Read again.
How good is it
when
thou art reproved?
Read on.
To show repentance.
To show repentance. Read on.
For so shalt thou escape willful sin.
It is better to reprove that you can escape willful sin. That's the point why we, that's the reason why we're around each other. So we can reprove another. So you won't die with the rest of the world. That's why correction is important. A man that hear wise counsel, he should be considered wise himself. Let's drop that. Let's go from that to book of Proverbs 15, verse 10. We got four more. Proverbs 15, verse 10.
The book of Proverbs, chapter 15, verse 10.
Here's the spirit of what not receiving correction is. The person that hates counsel, this is what the kind of person he is. Read on.
Correction is grievous.
Correction is what?
Grievous.
Read on.
Unto him.
That what?
That forsaketh the way.
Who is Christ? What did Christ come to do? What did Christ come to do, brothers? To redeem us, right? Sisters, what did Christ come to do? Y'all can speak, it's okay. What did Christ come to do? To save us, right? What did Christ say that he was? He was what? I heard it. He was the what? He was the what, brothers? Sisters, what did we say he was? Two sisters out of about 30-some sisters over there. He said he was the what? Brothers, he was the what? Read that again.
Correction is grievous.
Correction is grievous.
Unto him.
Unto him. Remember, all scripture is given by the inspiration of God. It's profitable for doctrine, correction, and reproof. He that what? He that is grievous to correction, or the scriptures is what?
Correction is grievous unto him that forsaketh the way.
So if you forsake correction, who you forsaken? Sisters, who you forsaken? So if somebody's trying to come to you and their counsel to you is godly inspired or divinely inspired, you rejecting Christ. In that day, guess what? You hate it here on this side of the earth. You're going to hate it when we get into the wilderness. That's what we got to be careful of. You ain't just going to upright change your spirit like, okay, I hated correction on that side, but on this side, I'm going to get it right. No, you ain't. Who you are now is who you're going to be. This is why we're here now, getting this stuff together now. Read it again.
Proverbs chapter 15, verse 10. Correction is grievous.
Remember, it says, rehearsing the righteous acts. This is what we're doing on this side of the earth. So what you're rehearsing now, what you're doing outside of the spirit, is what you're going to perform in the wilderness. Read it again.
Correction is grievous unto him that forsaketh the way.
Read on.
And he that hateth reproof.
And he that hateth what?
He that hateth reproof.
Read on.
Shall die.
We ain't got to explain that. Let's go to Proverbs chapter 141. 141 verse 5. Psalms.
The 141 verse 5.
What is correction for? How should we receive it? Remember, it says there's two types of shame. Being ashamed, one, it brings forth glory and it gives you grace. And there's one, being ashamed, where it's going to bring forth sin. You're going to be ashamed of correction, period, because it's not who you want to be, but they're correcting you so they can get out those impurities in you. So you can either, it can go two ways. It can give you grace and honor, or it can give you shame and you can end up dying. Let's read this.
Psalms 141, verse 5. Let the righteous smite me.
Let the what?
Let the righteous smite me.
Let the righteous smite me. Read on.
It shall be a kindness.
Let the righteous smite me. Talking about correction. Let the righteous smite me with this correction. It shall be what?
It shall be a kindness.
That don't mean the person hates you. And don't feel scared to come to the person, tell him when he's wrong. Because you got love for them. So when you receive the correction, you shouldn't take it as hate. Or they're your enemy. They're trying to show you some ways that you're doing wrong. So you won't die in the end. That's perfect love. Read on.
And let him reprove me.
And let him what?
Reprove me.
That's the smite. That's the definition of a smite. Read on.
It shall be an excellent oil.
That precious oil that God said nobody, if anybody even come close to making that oil, going to die. He said it's going to be an excellent oil. Read on.
Which shall not break my head.
It's not going to break your head. Somebody telling you what to do. Somebody telling you, look, brother, I think you should change this. Look, sister, I think you should change this way about you. It's not going to break your head. Listen to it. Read on.
For yet my prayer also shall be in their calamities.
Yet my prayer shall also be in their calamities. Now they know what I'm dealing with. They can also help me through this situation. That's how we got to take counsel. That's how we got to take correction. That's how we got to take reproof. Now, how should we go about correction? Because there's a wrong and a right way to do it also. Let's go to Ecclesiastes 31, verse 15. Again, we're almost done. Y'all bear with me. 31, 15.
The book of Sirach, chapter 31, verse 15.
We ain't missing New York, are we?
Sirach 31, 15. Nope. Judge okay. of thy neighbor by thyself.
What does scripture say, dude?
Judge of thy neighbor by thyself.
What is this going into? A situation might happen to you, right? And matter of fact, I want somebody to answer this. A situation might happen to you. Should you go and tell somebody else what that person is doing to you? Should it? Raise your hand if you think you should. Y'all heard my question? Sisters, is somebody doing something to you? Should you go to somebody else and tell that person, well, this person is doing this to me? Should that happen? What can happen if you do? Huh? One more time. Murmuring. And what can it do? It can cause hate. Sisters, y'all agree with that? Okay. Read that again.
Sirach chapter 31, verse 15. Judge of thy neighbor by thyself.
Judge of thy neighbor by thyself. That's why I said, who does correction involve? That's when corrections is brought about, what type of people are there? The person that's offended and the person that offended. Did I say that right? The person that is offended and the person that offended. Y'all know what I'm trying to say. The two people. Right? Say it again. The offender and the offended. Those are the people that's there. What's the reason for the third party? You got hatred. That's what it is. You want to tell somebody else so they can get you, so you can get them on your page. And now that person don't even know the ins and outs of the situation. Now they hate the person because you don't like them. That's the devil. God said those are six things. As a matter of fact, he said six things I hate. That one is an abomination to me. That's Proverbs 6:6. It says, judge of thy neighbor by thyself and do what?
And be discreet in every point.
Meaning bring out everything that is on your mind because you're trying to make what's wrong right. Bring out everything. Leave nothing unsaid. Not leave a leaf unturned because it will haunt you in the end. Now you still haven't got over the reason on why you can't be with this person. Or you can't interact with this person. Tell them everything that's on your mind, or her that's everything, or her everything that's on your mind, so y'all can grow together. Be discreet in every point, so y'all can overcome the obstacles. Read it again.
Judge of thy neighbor by thyself.
Read on.
And be discreet in every point.
And be discreet in every point. Now, how should you go about doing it? 2 Timothy's again.
Hey, Cap, real quick. I just want to touch on that about correction and how how our brothers and our sisters are supposed to take it. Let's go to James. Go to James real quick. Because at the end of the day, we are not here to bash nobody or ridicule anybody or continually, this is what you're doing, this is what you're doing. At the end of some type of correction or reproof of the scriptures, there's supposed to be a sense of peace that comes out of that. Y'all understand what I'm saying? So let's see real quick. James chapter 3, verse 17. James 3:17.
The book of James, chapter 3, verse 17.
And wisdom will show you that. When you coming out of the scriptures and you sharing to a brother or a sister their fault or their wrong, or you trying to correct them according to the scriptures, wisdom will tell you, okay, at the same time that I'm up here correcting this brother or sister, you giving them the way that it can make your situation or relationship better. By that, I mean we have to set peace. We are the children of peace, one of another. You understand what I'm saying? Read verse 17.
James chapter 3, verse 17. Mm-hmm. But the wisdom that is from above is first pure.
First of all, this wisdom that we speaking of is pure. Because the wisdom of the world would be like, yeah, you doing this, that, and the third. You need to get that together, whatever. And that's it. There's no solution to that. All right? When you're trying to tell somebody worldly what to do, what they're doing wrong, and how to do something right. Read on.
Then peaceable,
uh-huh,
gentle, and easy to be entreated.
So this is when somebody got a screw face because now, look, okay, he coming to me again or she got an issue. We supposed to entreat peace one of another. I should be able to go to this brother and be like, hey, bro, look, you erroring in this. And I can tell you that why, because I'm seeking your better interests. You understand? Because I love you. You my brother. We're going to talk to each other like family. Read that part again. It says entreat what? Easy.
But the wisdom is.
No. It says and easy.
And easy to be entreated.
You can come to your family. You can come to your family. You easy to be entreated. Read on.
Full of mercy.
Uh-huh.
And good fruits.
Right.
Without partiality.
Without partiality and judgment. Read. You being fair in judgment. Read.
And without hypocrisy.
You saying something and you guilty of the same thing. Read. And at the end of all of that, because all of that comes through correction. These are the things that happen. You're supposed to be able to come to your brother, your sister and be like, OK, I see you doing this, but you can work up on this and build yourself up in that. After all of that is said and done, read on.
And the fruit of righteousness.
If you are righteous, your fruits or your works, read,
is sown in peace.
It's already in you to set peace amongst your people. That's why in the scriptures, Matthew's 18, it says you gain that brother or that sister. You understand? So we should want to be corrected. You should want to be corrected by your own brother and your sister. Read on.
It's sown in peace of them that make peace.
And you have to make that happen. Make that peace. That's why Christ said, Matthew's 18, go to him. Make that peace. That's it.
And also with that, he said also, blessed are the peacemakers, yeah, for they shall inherit the kingdom of God. Absolutely. Making peace. So let's go from that to 2 Timothy 2:25.
2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 25. In meekness, instructing those that oppose themselves.
It says in meekness, instructing those that oppose themselves, meaning somebody done you wrong, you address them with meekness. Not in the intentions to defame or to bring about shame to where you destroy that individual. It says with meekness to them that oppose themselves. Now give me the definition of meekness. All right. Hold on before you go down to the, let's read the definition of it first. I still want that though. All right. It says enduring injury with patience and without resentment. Okay. There's another one. Okay. That's it. Not violent or strong. We can go down. Not violent or strong with meekness. Not violent or strong. His delivery varied from a meek to medallic patter to rapid fire scriptural allusions. All right. So I want to go into that rapid fire. This is the different. This is the opposite of being meek. Let's give the people now a visual of rapid fire. And then I'm going to explain why I pulled this. Give me that real quick. This is the opposite of being meek. What's rapid fire? Play this real quick. You got the volume off of it.
Some viewers may find the following video disturbing. Viewer discretion is advised.
We got the point. That's the opposite of being meek. Now it's your turn to speak. Remember you did this. I remember in 1945 you did this. In 88 you did this and did this. And I remember did this and you made me feel like this. And you got this and did this. And you left your socks on the ground. You remember you did this. You ain't cooked. I had to bring home food. And now you're talking about where the money went. And this. Rapid fire. Everything else to say. other than examine yourself and consider it.
Hey, Cap, you're right, because he had new guns, old guns, which is the old.
Had them in every department.
All of them.
Had them in every department. Every thought in your mind, you just digging up stuff. Matter of fact, give me the precept real quick. Let me show you something about that right there. They say, what type of person that does that? Waiting for a rebuttal, pulling up stuff that is unnecessary to the situation, or relevant. Proverbs 16:27.
The book of Proverbs, chapter 16, verse 27.
What type of man is this?
An ungodly man diggeth up evil.
An ungodly man, an ungodly woman in masculine terms. That we're talking about dealing with both. Diggeth up evil. Something that is relevant to the situation. Digging it up just to throw it on the line again. That means you haven't forgave. Right. You waiting for an opportunity to get back. Okay? And say, an ungodly man diggeth up evil. Read on.
And in his lips there is as a burning fire.
Meaning you ain't trying to restore that spirit. You trying to bring out your point to make you feel better. That's your lust. Let's go back to Timothy's. Let's finish this off. Timothy's chapter 2 verse 25.
2 Timothy chapter 2 verse 25.
Start at 24.
24. And the servant of the Lord must not strive.
That's the reason why we should. This is one of the things that we shouldn't be looking for when we're bringing out correction or dealing with correction. Neither party should be striving. Read on.
But be gentle unto all men, apt to teach, patient.
And that's one of the key components in dealing with it. Read on.
In meekness.
And what?
In meekness.
Read on.
Instructing those that oppose themselves.
And your purpose for doing that and posing and going to them that oppose themselves, your purpose for doing that is that they're what? Read on.
If God preadventure will give them repentance.
To do what?
To the acknowledging of the truth.
To do what?
To the acknowledging of the truth.
Meaning you want to better the situation. You're trying to seek peace out of the situation. Read on.
And that they may recover themselves out of the snare of the devil.
That they might recover themselves out of the snare of the devil. Again, remember it says a yoke. The putting forth of the finger, that thing, that whole situation is like a yoke. Somebody can't wait to do it in the situation. Read on.
Who are taken captive by him at his will.
Because if you do so, you taken captive by the devil at his will. At his will. Let's go from that. Proverbs 27 verse 5. I hope ain't nobody in here talking about this class don't apply to me either. It'll apply to me. I know that. It should apply to everybody in here. Everybody should be considering. Everybody looking screw face in here. This should be over. I ain't got nothing to do with this situation. And then you the person that's taken captive at his will. If that's the case, why are you here? Read on.
Proverbs chapter 27 verse 5. Open rebuke.
What?
Open rebuke.
What?
Open rebuke.
Now I'm going to wait till later.
Open rebuke.
Now I'm going to wait till another situation happen up so I can bring it out.
Open rebuke.
Now I'm going to wait till somebody else see it.
Open rebuke.
Is what?
Is better than secret love.
Open rebuke is better than secret love. Meaning going to that person and revealing it to them is better than secret love. Meaning you having the intentions for, you have a good purpose or intentions for them. They're supposed to know that. If you know that they're doing something wrong, why would you wait? Go to them and reveal it to them. Open rebuke is better than secret love. Love is correcting them. Secret love is when you hide it and you hold on to it, not telling them. You waiting for that person to implode. That's hatred. Open rebuke is better than secret love. Read on.
Faithful are the wounds of
faithful are the what?
Faithful are the wounds.
Let the righteous smite me. It should be a kindness. Faithful are the wounds what?
Of a friend.
Of a friend. Read on.
But the kisses of an enemy are deceitful.
The kisses of an enemy are deceitful. Oh, brother, you all right. Don't worry about that. You all right. I don't know why they came to you and told you that. I don't see that. Nobody, you know, ain't nobody else see that. Meaning you the only person telling them that. Nobody else sees that. Well, how you know that? That's enemies, that's kisses of deceit. That's kisses of deceit. Be willing to hear every godly discourse. Let's go from that to 1 Corinthians. And what I said earlier about just leadership, if somebody is doing something wrong, you don't have to bring it up here to tell that person. You do it. You've seen it. You do it. If it's wrong, it's wrong. You don't got to bring it to leadership to correct it. If you can deal with it, that's why Moses set up men. If the matter was small, they handled small matters. If the matter was too big, they brought it to somebody else. That's how we got to operate. If something is wrong, you address it. Sisters, you address it. Go to that sister and let her know. Brothers, same with you. Nobody up here ain't got to reach our ears first. So I ain't know if I should come to that person or not. Why not? You saw it, right? They offended you, right? Go tell them. Make peace with the person. Let's go from that to 1 Corinthians 11. 1 Corinthians 11, 18.
The book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 11, verse 18.
Last one.
For first of all, when ye come together in the church, I hear that there be divisions among you, and I partly believe it.
He said, y'all been through too much. I partly believe it. Now, y'all been through, I've been making frequent visits to y'all. I've been writing letters to y'all. I partly believe it, that y'all going through this. I hear there be divisions amongst y'all. I partly believe it. Read on.
For there must be also heresies among you.
I expect heresies to come amongst you. I'm talking about Paul regarding the church. That's what was going on. Just giving you a brief summary on what he was talking about. Read on.
That they which are approved may be made manifest among you. When you come together, therefore, into one place, this is not to eat the Lord's Supper. For in eating, everyone taketh before other his own supper. And one is hungry, and another is drunken.
So he said, the reason why we have this feast of the Lord, it ain't here so you can just come here and just be eat and drink, or just so you can be a glutton or a drunkard. This ain't the reason why we coming together to eat the Lord's feast. It's for us to come together so we may grow together. We eat together because we enjoy each other's company. We prefer one another. But y'all coming here for the wrong reasons. This is what Paul was telling them. Read on.
What? Have ye not houses to eat and to drink in?
Paul said, y'all got y'all houses for that. Don't come here and do this. This is not what this is about. Read on.
Or despise ye the church of God, and shame them that have not.
And shame those that don't have nothing to bring here. It ain't for you to bring as much as you can so you can shame somebody else. Read on.
What shall I say to you? Shall I praise you in this? I praise you not.
Now I want to jump down. I want to finish this off. Let's jump down to verse 31.
1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 31. For if we would judge ourselves.
If we could, we consider ourselves. Consider what's in each and every one of us. Consider our ways. Read on.
We should not be judged.
We should not be judged. Read on.
But when we are judged.
But when we are judged, when we're corrected of one another in here. Read on.
We are chastened of the Lord.
It is the chastisement of who?
Of the Lord.
Of the Lord. It's divine inspired. Read on. Divinely inspired. Read on.
That we should not be condemned with the world.
So the purpose of us being judged on this side of the earth or corrected on this side of the earth is for what?
That we should not be condemned with the world.
How does the world pass away? With a great noise. That's what the scripture said. Let me get straight to the point. With a great noise, with fervent heat, where all the elements shall be burnt up thereof. He said he's giving you the correction now so you won't die with the rest of the world. We said that earlier. This is the reason why we come together to eat the Lord's feast. So we may prefer one another. Eating knowing that Christ died for our sins, that we may grow together. But some of y'all are here for the wrong reasons. This is what Paul was saying. And I can safely say now, consider it for yourselves if you fall into this category. Some people come to the Sabbath because they think it's another, that's the thought I'm getting into, because it's another way to skip the club. You don't have the club no more, so you just come here and just the hangout spot. What's the word I'm looking for? I said it this morning. I forgot it. It's a word I'm looking for. It's another substitute for you going to the club. You understand, the truth is a way of life. This is supposed to be who we are. This ain't just for one day out of the week so you can just skip the club and feel better about it. It is a way of life. Being an Israelite is a... That's who your nationality, first and foremost. Keeping God's commandments is a way of life. This ain't something you're supposed to be doing just on the Sabbath, meaning what? Superhero Israelite. You come here, spend a couple hours at the Sabbath, Then you leave early, nobody knows you, and you go back home and continue the rest of your life. That's called Sunday school Israelites. Sunday school Israelites. Come here on the Sabbath, and then you get outside the doors, you back the damn super nigga. That's not what this is about. We in here so we may grow together. Now, what I said earlier goes back to what I'm saying now. Is that a scripture saying that y'all have to stay here all day to the Sabbath? No, it ain't. It's just the scripture says keep the Sabbath. But am I telling you something that's wrong? No, I'm not. Prefer one another. That's going back to what I said. I might not be able to quote the verse to you about saying you should stay here. Why y'all going home early? It's a Sabbath. That's not a scripture me telling y'all to say, but I'm saying, I'm advising you, maybe you should stay. The scripture says prefer one another, not forsaking the assembly. But if you wait to wait for the sun to peek down so you can get up out of here, you're in the wrong spirit. This is something I look forward to coming here because this is one day out of the week I got to do this. So I'm going to spend every, matter of fact, sometimes we get up out of here, what, 4 o'clock in the morning? I love every bit of it. Tired as hell the next day, but I don't care. So, again, some of us got to get into that spirit. Leaving early, it ain't going to help you. If this is all you got and look forward to, then I don't see why you should not desire this every day of the week. Get to know one another. How many of y'all sisters know each other on this side? How many of y'all know each other? Y'all know each other over there? All y'all know each other over there? Okay, it's time to start working on it. If you can't look around and say, I know her. If you look around and say, I don't know nobody in here, but this is my third week, then you got a problem. Brothers, you too. If you look right behind you or in front of you and don't know nobody in front of you, you got problems. You surviving on your own. Two are better than one. That's what the scriptures say. Right. So if you think you can survive on your own, then you saying you can outdo the scripture. Let's finish on. Oh, good. You got something to say?
I got two scriptures, but go ahead.
All right, let's finish on. So we 33.
1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 33. Wherefore, my brethren, when you come together to eat, tarry one for another.
Okay, tarry one for another. Now he's getting back into the thought of what he was going into. Point I want to get out of that is 31 through 32. The point of correction, so we judge on this side so we can seek the kingdom or have the kingdom. Correction is necessary. All right. Officer, you got something? I'm finished.
Just to back up what you said about us knowing each other, you know, being in this building and not knowing who each other is. And this goes towards helping us to be each other's keeper, to help prevent each other from sin. A lot of times we sit back and we watch things and then we feel like I shouldn't say anything. Like, you know, you offend a brother or sister before they sin. Right. No, you should say something to to keep them from sin. I got two scriptures. I want you to get up 1 Thessalonians 5 and 12 first.
I just want to say that what you said, that's important because Ezekiel said the same thing. If you see a brother do wrong and you don't say nothing, his blood is on your hands because you're supposed to be that brother's keeper.
Absolutely. I'm done.
1 Thessalonians 5 and 12.
The book of 1 Thessalonians, chapter 5, verse 12. And we beseech you, brethren, to know them which labor among you.
Read that again.
And we beseech you, brethren, to know them which labor among you.
So we should know each and every one of us that labor in this truth that are in this building. So now I got the question, are we all laborers? Or do some of us just come because, like Kevin said, it's just a hangout. It's just a place to meet brothers and sisters that like to wear purple. Are we truly laborers in this truth? Because, like the Kevin said, if you out here and you really in captivity and you really despise having to go serve other nations, listen to the ungodly music and conversations and so on throughout the week, you should be happy to get here and see people that are like mind with you. And Ezekiel says this is a little sanctuary. So if we don't know each other, why are we up here for? Now I'm going to give you an example of how Paul dealt with it. Get on Romans 16. Do a little power reading, officers. Start at verse 3.
The book of Romans, chapter 16, verse 3. Greet Priscilla and Aquila, my helpers in Christ Jesus, who have for my life laid down their own necks, unto whom not only I give thanks, but also all the churches of the Gentiles.
Fellow laborers. Read on.
Likewise, greet the church that is in their house. Salute my well-beloved Afrentius, who is the first fruits of Achaia unto Christ. Greet Mary, who bestowed much labor unto us. Salute Adronicus and Junia, my kinsmen and my fellow prisoners, who are of note among the apostles, who also were in Christ before me.
Okay, jump down to verse 16.
Verse 16. Salute one another with an holy kiss. The churches of Christ salute you.
So you see what Paul did? Paul knew each and every one by name. He greeted and he knew each and every one by name. So we ask again, do you even know the brother or sister that's sitting to the right or the left of you? Because if not, you know what? You got that Christian church mind in you. Because that's what they do in the Christian church. They give each other fake hugs, act like they care about what happened to you during the week. They be up in church for about, an hour and a half. Now it's time to go to Denny's or one of those smorgasbords.
Hey, officer, you know what? It's real heavy because that's Christ-like. Take Christ for an example. He didn't die for us because he didn't know us. He knew us. He had the knowledge of all of us. That's why he died, because he loved us. So in the event of, like I said earlier, the scripture said laboring, that's a part of this labor. That's a part of the truth, is knowing the people that you around, knowing your brother and sister. It ain't no cliche like, oh, yeah, hug your neighbor and all that they do in the Christian church. You got to know who you struggling, who you striving with, who you dealing with the same afflictions with. If this brother got an issue with something, that's your problem, too. Now you got to try to build him up from that or her up from that.
Okay, that.
I'm sorry, just one more scripture real quick, because Bishop always taught us this. He gave us this scripture. Go to Hebrews chapter 12, verse 11 real quick. About correction. When correction comes out, how the correctee and the corrector.
The offended and the offended.
Did I say that at the same time? Anyway, y'all know what it means. Okay, the offender and the defendant. Here we go. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 11. Let's get this real quick.
The book of Hebrews chapter 12, verse 11.
Right.
Now, no chastening for the present seemeth to be joyous.
The chastening is that we come from of the scriptures. All right. This is the person that's correcting the brother that or sister that may be in error. Read it again.
No chastening for the present seemeth to be joyous.
It might not seem joyous because he may seem like he's rough speaking. But the scripture says you may have to save some with fire and some with compassion. Y'all remember that in the book of Jude? So it says, now no chastening for the present seemeth to be joyous. It's going to come maybe at a certain way that you don't feel comfortable. But read.
But grievous,
because don't nobody want to sit here and just be bashed all the time, right? Grievous, it becomes grievous to you because you forsake the way, like the scripture says in Proverbs. Read on.
Nevertheless,
what?
Afterward, it yieldeth the peaceable fruit of...
It all should come back to fruit of peace. Your works of peace, meaning it's supposed to bring forth fruits in your peaceable fruits in your actions, meaning righteousness, all right? Plain and simple. You're supposed to be able to change from all of that, of the correction that's coming out, and change. We had a brother down here. He had some things to work on in his work being a soldier. So the brother, he was corrected by the bishop. Correction went out. And then long behold, afterwards, the peaceableness of the fruits of his being corrected, he was able. Now he got a house at a different country. He got a wife, and he got himself a little. He got a job, and the things that he was dealing with was rough correction at first. So you're supposed to be able to take the correction as something that's good for you all the time. I just want to get back to that because that's what this truth is all about, being corrected and changing. And if we all doing that, we got love for one another.
Shalom, Israel. I'm Elder Nathaniel, Israel United in Christ. YouTube likes to shut our channels down, as some of you have noticed, ever so often. Subscribing to Join IUIC will assure you will always stay connected to our YouTube accounts. We want to do our best to make sure this truth gets out. Please click and join our subscriber YouTube channel called Join IUIC to stay linked to all of our videos. So again, please make sure you subscribe to this Join IUIC channel to get your latest updates on all our YouTube channels. Shalom.